Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 5th August 2020. These are the list of news articles chosen for today's analysis. It has been provided along with the page numbers of different editions of Hindu newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping for the displayed articles is given in the description box and also in the comment section. Let's move on to the first news article discussion for today. Our first discussion for today is based on this news article, which talks about the Odisha government's plan to start cage fishing. The government of Odisha has come out with a new policy to promote cage culture in the medium and large reservoirs. Now, this new policy has been framed because there is a high demand and consumption of freshwater fishes in the state. Now, when you come across new methods or technologies related to cultivation, production, animal rearing, or anything related to agriculture, please take note of it, because we can expect direct questions on these new methods in mains examination and also in prelims examination. So in this context only, it becomes important to know about cage culture and the government policy towards it. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. First, you should know that fish can be cultured in one of the four culture systems, and they include ponds, raceways, recirculating systems, or cages. Now here, the raceway aquaculture is also known as flow-through system. It is a system which uses a continuously running source of water or an artificial channel of water to grow fish. And then in a recirculating aquaculture systems, the water is reused many times by passing it through treatment processes so that waste can be removed and the quality of the water can be restored. But our today's discussion is based on caged aquaculture. So what does it mean? In a caged aquaculture system, the fish or even the shellfish is grown in a mesh enclosure, as you can see here. So this cage has a completely rigid frame. This means they are generally enclosed on all sides except for leaving an opening at the top for feeding and handling the stock, that is the fishes or the shellfishes. And this cage culture uses existing water resources such as ponds, rivers, estuaries, open ocean also. But more importantly, it confines the fish inside some type of mesh enclosure. Now, since the mesh retains the fish, it makes it easier to feed, observe, and harvest those fishes. Now, since this mesh enclosure is not an opaque structure, it allows the water to pass freely between the fish and the surrounding water resources. And thus, it helps to maintain good quality water, and it also helps in removing the wastes. So, what are the advantages of this caged aquaculture? Firstly, they require comparatively low capital outlay because they use existing water bodies. So there is no need for us to build an artificial channel of water. And they use simple technology. There is no need for any specialized knowledge to use this method. Then this method augments fish yield because it optimizes the use of all available water area. And then it also helps to reduce the pressure on land for farms and nurseries. Then another advantage is that this method can be used to clean up the eutrophicated waters by harvesting of caged planktivorous species. See, as you know, eutrophication means excessive richness of nutrients in a water body, which happens due to frequent runoff from the land. And this causes dense growth of plant life, like you would have seen green algal growth on a water body. Now, this can be cleaned up by harvesting caged planktivorous species. See, planktivorous species means those organisms which feed on planktonic food, including zooplankton and phytoplankton. And this method is currently practiced in Malaysia and Singapore. Then apart from this, other advantages include a very high production per unit area. Then it facilitates for towing off in case of pollution. That is, if the water gets polluted, then the cage can be easily moved from one place to another. Then it provides safety from predators. Then the fish is easy to harvest in a caged aquaculture. So like this, there are many advantages in this method. Now, what are the disadvantages in this method? See, there are concerns about the environmental impacts of these methods. Firstly, the intensive culture is believed to accelerate eutrophication. So just now we saw that eutrophicated water can be cleaned up, but only when we harvest planktivorous species. So what about when other species are grown? So because of this, experts believe that intensive cage aquaculture accelerates eutrophication. And then in fast flowing rivers, intensive fish culture or semi-intensive fish culture is not advisable because there will be excessive loss of feed. That is, there will be food losses since the food will be washed away easily in a fast flowing river or fast flowing water body. Then other disadvantages include high demand on oxygen and water flow, then dependence on artificial food, because since the fish will be caged, the producer would have to provide the artificial food. Then there is also risk of rapid spread of diseases since the fish is in a caged environment. Then already natural waters are used for many multi-purposes, and this method could come in conflict with those purposes also. So these are some of the disadvantages of this method. Now, what is the scope of this caged aquaculture in India? See, here you should note that in the last 5 decades, the contribution of marine fish in the total production of the country has decreased. It has decreased from 71% in 1950s to 35% in 2015. See here, note that marine fisheries are carried out in oceans and seas, including bays and estuaries. But inland fisheries or inland fishing are carried out in freshwater. And this decline has happened due to a corresponding increase in inland fish production. Now, since India is rich in open water resources like reservoirs, lakes and floodplain wetlands, etc., there is enormous scope in India to increase the production through caged aquaculture. Now, in this regard, we should know that unplanned expansion of any activity can lead to adverse impacts in terms of environmental integrity and social equity, because this could lead to over-exploitation. So that means we need a proper guideline to carry out this method of culture system. And because of this, Indian government constituted a national level committee to develop guidelines for cage culture in inland open waters. It was constituted in April 2016 and they brought some guidelines with respect to cage culture. So we'll see that now. Firstly, they talk about the shape and type of cages, such as the shape can be rectangular or round, but round cages are considered more suitable for caged aquaculture. Then durable and stable cage materials are essential for achieving better results. Then second, they also talk about the most important aspect of this, which is site selection. According to the guidelines, large, deep reservoirs and lakes need to be chosen for cage aquaculture, and the small and shallow water bodies should not be chosen for cage aquaculture. It is because small water bodies do not have sufficient depths for the cages to remain afloat during the lean season. That is when the water flow is less. And importantly, the sites should be selected based on the safety of location and based on the availability of smooth culture operations that would minimize user conflicts. So because of this, the guidelines mention that those sites should be avoided which have turbulence wave or excessive wave, which have bad water quality and which are near to dense human habitations, and even dams should be avoided for cage culture. Now next is water quality. Water quality is important to ensure that the fish is healthy. So according to this guidelines, it needs to be ensured that the water body is either oligotrophic, that is it is low nutrient content, or it is mesotrophic, that is it has moderate nutrient content. And this has to be made sure before starting the cage culture. It is because the cage culture operations will increase nutrient load. It will increase the biological oxygen demand and chemical oxygen demand in the water bodies. Now, this point is important since excessive nutrient load from cage culture inputs, such as especially the feeds, that is the food for the fish, can create eutrophic conditions with disastrous consequences to the ecosystem. And because of this, the guidelines also suggest that there is a necessity to conduct an environment impact assessment before cages are installed in reservoirs. Then the guidelines mandate that continuous fish health monitoring is required, and as far as possible, use of antibiotics and chemicals should be avoided while using this method, so that we can maintain the water quality and we can also maintain the health of the fish, which will be ultimately consumed by humans. In this discussion, we discussed about a new method known as cage culture or cage aquaculture. We saw what are its advantages and disadvantages, and we also saw the guidelines provided by Indian government regarding this. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion. This discussion is based on this op-ed article, which focuses on the alleged human rights violations in the Jammu and Kashmir Valley. Now, the author of this article mentions about several rights violations relating to preventive detention, then such as a difficulty in accessing information through internet, etc. But today we'll focus on the issues related to preventive detention only. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, first, let us understand preventive detention and related constitutional and legal provisions. When we talk about constitutional provisions, the fundamental right provided under Article 22 of Indian Constitution explicitly mentions about preventive detention. This article deals with protection against arrest and detention in certain cases. See, there are two types of detention. One is punitive detention and the other one is preventive detention. Punitive is to punish a person after a trial and conviction in a court has happened for offense which is committed by that person. But preventive detention is to detain a person without trial and conviction. But this doesn't mean that the person is punished for a past offense. It simply means preventing that person from committing an offense. So that means preventive detention is a precautionary measure. And according to Article 22 of Indian Constitution, no law can provide for preventive detention of a person for more than 3 months without obtaining opinion of advisory board. That is, if the government wants to detain any person under preventive detention for more than 3 months, then it has to constitute an advisory board. And such advisory board should consist of persons who are or who have been judges of High Court, or at least who are qualified to be appointed as judges of High Court. And in this article, clause 5 is very important because it mentions that when a person is under preventive detention, then the authority shall communicate to such person about the grounds on which the preventive detention order has been made. That is, the person has to be informed about the grounds on which she or he has been detained. And this has to be done as soon as possible. Now, such person should also be provided with an opportunity of making representation against this order. Now, since these two important provisions are given in Article 22, it is a part of fundamental right for that person. First, the person has to be informed about the grounds on which they have been detained. And second, they should be provided with an opportunity to make a representation. Now, regarding this, also know that Indian Constitution has empowered both Parliament and the state legislatures to make laws regarding preventive detention. Because first, entry 9 of Union List deals with preventive detention, but it is for the reasons connected with the defense, foreign affairs, or the security of India and persons subjected to such detention. And then again in entry 3 of the concurrent list, there is a mention of preventive detention. And this preventive detention is for reasons connected with the security of a state, for maintenance of public order, or for the maintenance of supplies and services essential to the community, and also related to the persons who are detained. Now, since preventive detention subject is also mentioned in concurrent list, state governments are also empowered to make laws on it. Now, based on this only, currently there are preventive detention laws already in force in our country, such as the National Security Act of 1980. Then you'd have heard about the Jammu and Kashmir Public Safety Act of 1978. Especially this Jammu and Kashmir Public Safety Act, or in short PSA of 1978, it was repeatedly used, or it is even repeatedly used to detain many politicians in Jammu and Kashmir. So this is the background that you should know with respect to preventive detention. Now, coming to this editorial, in this author has mentioned that the state is empowered to declare a building or house as a sub-jail, that is subsidiary jail. Now, this power is given to the state government by the Prisons Act of 1894. Under this act, prison also means any place which has been declared by the state government to be a subsidiary jail, and this has to be declared by a general order or a special order. So this is how the residential accommodations of some political leaders are converted into sub-jails. And after this, the resident of that residential accommodation comes under house arrest. Now, in this case, what happens is the state government or the state takes over the property for this purpose. And the owner of this property is entitled to rent or compensation for the use of that property and for occupying that property. That is, there is compulsory takeover of the property. Now, this compulsory takeover of property has been an issue of great concern in states like Mizoram, because there vast tracts of land were taken over by the armed forces for curbing insurgency. But they were taken over without paying any compensation or rent. And according to the author, the residents of Jammu and Kashmir are also facing similar issues now. So this is one of the issues with respect to preventive detention. Then another issue is ignoring the procedural safeguards provided under the fundamental right of Article 22 for preventive detention. For example, we already saw that it is the fundamental right of the person to be communicated about the grounds of the arrest, and the person has to be given opportunity to make representations. But the author is stating that this is not happening. So what is Supreme Court's stand on this? See, on several occasions, Supreme Court has mentioned that if there is an unexpected delay of even 1 or 2 days in dealing with the representation, then the order of preventive detention is vitiated or not legally valid. That means the person can no longer be held in preventive detention. And in this scenario, you should know about one important Supreme Court judgment, which was given in a 1981 case law. It is the A.K. Roy versus Union of India case law. Now, in this judgment, Supreme Court mentioned that the laws of preventive detention cannot introduce procedural measures of punitive kind by the way of backdoor, that is, by using indirect means. So what does Supreme Court mean here by saying introducing procedural measures of punitive kind? Here, Supreme Court also gave an example, such as if a person is kept in detention in a place other than the one where the person habitually resides, then this amounts to punitive measure or a measure of a punitive kind. And further, Supreme Court also noted that the use of preventive detention without following the procedure will actually make it punishment or conviction without a trial. And as we know, it is our fundamental right not to be punished or convicted without trial. So such kind of measures which violate the preventive detention procedures, like keeping a person in a place other than where he or she habitually resides, then it outrightly violates the fundamental right under Article 22. So keep this in mind. That is all about this discussion. In this discussion, you should focus on the constitutional and legal provisions related to preventive detention. And then whenever you see a mains question related to preventive detention, you can also mention about this Supreme Court judgment. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now, this next discussion is based on this news article, which talks about United Nations' recent policy brief on the pandemic's impact on education. So in this context, we'll discuss in brief about the major findings of UN, which are mentioned in this policy brief. The policy brief noted that COVID-19 pandemic has caused the largest disruption of education in history because it has created a universal impact on learners and also on teachers around the world. The policy brief also noted that by mid-April 2020, 94% of learners worldwide were affected by the pandemic. It also mentioned the early 2020 estimate of the financing gap in education to reach the Sustainable Development Goal number 4. The financing gap was a shocking $148 billion annually. And now it is estimated that the COVID-19 crisis will increase this financing gap by up to 1/3. In this context, know that SDG 4 is to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and to promote lifelong learning opportunities for all. Now, in this regard, the policy brief also noted that this interruption of the school year will have a disproportionately negative impact on the most vulnerable pupils from poor economic background. And moreover, their presence at home can also complicate the economic situation of parents because they have to take care of the children who are at home. And with special concern, the policy brief also tells about the condition of girls in this regard. We can imagine the condition of girls who are forced to take up domestic chores and farm works. Also, children with disabilities and refugee children are suffering due to the lack of inclusion in the strategies for distance learning. So because of this, they are also losing on the education. And more importantly, the policy brief mentions about the economic impact of COVID-19 on education. It mentions that the pandemic will widen the inequities in education achievement. In this regard, UNESCO has estimated that around 23.8 million additional children and youth may drop out of school or they will not have access to school next year due to the pandemic's economic impact alone. Now, we know that there are many indirect consequences of dropouts, which is also noted by this policy brief, like it includes food insecurity due to loss of school meals, then economic instability due to lack of education, then violence against women and girls, etc., etc. Now, this disruption also concerns health and psychological services because, as you know, some education institutions also serve as platforms for prevention, diagnosis, and counseling. So, based on these findings, UN has called for some action areas to revamp the education system in the world. First, schools should be reopened by taking steps to suppress the virus transmission. Secondly, education should be given priority in financing decisions of the governments and international communities. And it should be done by strengthening domestic resource mobilization and also by international coordination for mitigating the crisis in education sector. And thirdly, there should be focus on equity and inclusion. So in this regard, target should be on the hardest to reach, that is to reach the children from remote areas, to reach girls, to reach children with disabilities, etc. And finally, the governments should accelerate a positive change in teaching and learning. This means that there should be focus on addressing learning losses and preventing dropouts. The policy brief also prescribes to remove the technological barriers by investing in digital infrastructure and by lowering connectivity costs, so that even the children who are hardest to reach can be benefited from digital education. So that is all about this discussion. From this discussion, you have to take note on the impacts of COVID-19 on education, which is very helpful from Maine's perspective. And finally, we also saw some suggestions from UN. You can also mention these in your Maine's answers whenever a relevant question appears. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Moving on to the next discussion based on these news articles. These news articles and this editorial discusses about the recent executive order by US President. It is an executive order on the aligning federal contracting and hiring practices with the interests of American workers. So in this context, let us what this order is about and what are its implications. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. On 3rd August, the Office of US President has issued an executive order. This order has given directions to the federal agencies of USA to review their policy of contracting or subcontracting foreign workers. And this includes those on H-1B visa. See here for your reference, we have given you the contractor's role and subcontractor's role. You can just read it for your understanding. Now, this move by USA is yet another example for US protectionism, if you see from a broader perspective. Because for the past several years, under current administration of Donald Trump, we have been seeing many measures to protect the interests of Americans. And this is one such measure. And for this purpose, the current US administration has largely targeted the inflow of skilled foreign workers with number of announcements. Like in April 2020, US announced that it would be suspending the issuance of green cards, which in turn halts the legal migration into USA. Then in June 2020 also, USA decided to suspend new issuance of 4 non-immigrant visas till the end of 2020. And one such visa which was suspended is the H-1B visa. Other visas are H-2B visa, J-category visa and L-category visa. If you remember, we discussed about these categories in detail on our 24th June Hindi News analysis. On that day, we also saw about the implications of this move on Indians. Now, similarly, this latest executive order by USA is also going to affect H-1B visa holders in particular. Now, for defending this move, USA has noted that the contract jobs create opportunities for US workers. But when employers trade such American jobs for temporary foreign labor, like to those who hold the H-1B visa, then it reduces the opportunities for US workers. And this executive order is especially targets federal agencies because in certain regions of USA, the federal agencies are the largest employers. And this is the reason given by USA for defending its current executive order. See, the background for this order is an announcement made by federally owned Tennessee Valley Authority. This Tennessee Valley Authority has recently announced that it would outsource 20% of its technology jobs to companies which are based in foreign countries. So threatened by this order that even other federal agencies will follow the same, which might in turn reduce opportunities for Americans, the current US administration has issued this executive order. So what are the implications of this move by USA? See, this executive order particularly targets H-1B visa holders, as we saw already. It is because this order directs certain federal departments to take actions to protect the US workers from any adverse effects on wages and working conditions that are caused by the employment of H-1B visa holders at job sites. And this in turn especially affects Indian nationals because Indian nationals are granted 60-70% of H-1B visas annually. So Indian nationals will be affected. Apart from this, the IT and IT enabled services firms which are based in India that send workers from India would be affected by this move. Then this order will also affect the corporate companies of India who invest in US economy and create jobs there, because they will be at disadvantage to not utilize the Indian workforce in USA, since the Indian workforce is known for its skill and also for its cheap labor. So all these implications could produce a ripple effect in the bilateral economic space between India and USA. Thus, it might create problems in India-US bilateral ties also. But here you should note that it is not only India which will be affected, because even USA will be affected by this move. For example, NASSCOM, that is the National Association of Software and Service Companies, has mentioned that this US's decision appears to be based on misperceptions and misinformation. Now, NASSCOM has noted this. This executive order has been issued at a time when there is huge shortage of skills in the STEM in USA. That is, STEM stands for science, technology, engineering, and management sectors in USA. With respect to this, you should note that in US, the unemployment in other occupations apart from computer occupations grew from 4.1% to 13.5% in May 2020. But at the same time, skilled workers are not available to fill these shortages in USA. Now, to fill these shortages only, the short-term non-immigrant visas such as H-1B and then L-category visas are issued, and they help to bridge this shortage. But now, since USA has taken a decision which directly affects a particular category of visa holders, then it is going to directly affect certain sectors in US economy. In addition to this, NASSCOM has also noted that it is important for USA to be able to access talent that is critical to the recovery phase post-COVID-19 lockdown. So that means the measures like the current executive order, which restricts access to talent, will slow down the recovery phase of US economy. And it will also slow down its innovation and research and development also. So these are some of the implications of US's decision. Now, in this scenario, keep in mind that the presidential elections will happen in USA in November 2020. And like around the world, even in USA, unemployment rate has increased due to COVID-19 lockdown. So the editorial particularly notes that the present US administration under Mr. Donald Trump is trying to score political points with polarized decisions in order to be re-elected. That is, certain measures of current US administration is trying to divide employers into two contrasting groups. On one side, there are American workers, and the other side are the immigrant workers. So instead of making use of the diverse population to build America's economy, it is said that the current US administration is building a hate culture in USA that immigrants like H-1B category visa holders are stealing jobs of Americans. So by issuing executive orders like the recent one, the current government of USA is trying to get the support of people. And that is why the editorial has mentioned that this executive order is only for political gains. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The respect practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now, let us take up the next discussion based on this news article. It mentions that the Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services, that is INCOIS, is developing a seasonal and climate forecast system for surface waves. See, as you know, in 2018, we heard the news of damage which was caused by a high wave to the Indian coastline from Kerala to Maharashtra. Now, the increased damage caused by high wave activity are common during cyclones. It is common during southwest monsoon and also during swell surges. So because of this, INCOIS is developing a seasonal and climate forecast system for surface waves. Now, this will help to have a better coastal and navigational protection plan for India. Now, as part of this, they have also investigated the link between wave activity in the Indian Ocean and an important summer intra-seasonal variation called as BSISO. BSISO stands for Boreal Summer Intra-Seasonal Oscillation. So what is this BSISO? As you know, the Indian summer monsoon has vigorous intra-seasonal oscillations, or in short, ISOs. And they are in the form of active and weak or break spells of monsoon rainfall within the summer monsoon season itself. And the seasonal variations in the tropical ISOs are usually represented with two distinct modes. One is Madden-Julian oscillation, and the second one is Boreal Summer Intra-Seasonal Oscillation, that is MJO and BSISO. We have discussed about MJO in our Target 2020 November analysis also. Today, we will just focus on BSISO. See, in this, boreal refers to northern regions. So, BSISO is the intra-seasonal oscillations that are happening in the northern part of Earth when it is summer there. Here, know that BSISO dominates during boreal summer, that is from June to October, and MJO dominates during boreal winter, that is from December to April. See, the BSISO of the Asian summer monsoon is one of the most prominent sources of short-term climate variability in the global monsoon system. If we compare this with MJO, then BSISO is more complex in nature with prominent northward propagation. And its variability also extends much further from the equator. See, this BSISO consists of alternating episodes of active and suppressed convection that moves northward with 30 to 60 day mode in the Indian Ocean. And then it moves westward, propagating 10 to 20 day mode in the northwestern tropical Pacific Ocean. And the most important feature of this BSISO is the propagation of clouds and convection from about 5 degrees south to 25 degrees north over the South Asian monsoon region. See, to put it simply, we can say that BSISO has significant potential to influence the seasonal monsoon. And according to today's news article, the active phase of BSISO creates significant wave activity over the North Indian Ocean during the summer monsoon season, that is from June to September or October. And this is one of the reasons for the high waves that are seen over the Arabian Sea at that time. And these high waves have adverse impact on marine activities, and they also have impact on navigation. Then it also leads to intense coastal erosion, and more floods are expected in the coastal regions. So from this discussion, you should understand that the BSISO has an impact on the tropical Indian Ocean surface wave heights during the boreal summer season. And understanding this fact is crucial for the improvement of the wave forecast system, which is beneficial for many marine applications. And in turn, it will also help the coastal communities. So that is all about this discussion. Today, we discussed about BSISO in a very brief manner, and hopefully in the coming days, we will see it elaborately. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now, we have come to the last session for the day, that is the practice questions discussion session. This question is based on cage culture or cage aquaculture. It is a three-statement question. First statement asks, fish or shellfish is grown in a mesh which has a completely rigid frame. The statement is correct. We saw that cage which has a rigid frame is used for fish culture. And here if you see, the question asks for the incorrect statements. So one should not be an answer. So eliminate options A and B. Now the second statement mentions, small and shallow water bodies are best suited. Now, even if you don't know about this statement, from the remaining options, you can say that statement 2 is definitely incorrect. A large deep reservoirs and lakes are suitable for cage culture because it is needed for the cage to remain afloat. Now, the third statement is water is reused many times by passing it through treatment processes to remove waste and to restore the quality. Now, this statement is incorrect. First, because in the discussion, we saw that this method of aquaculture uses natural water bodies where the water is naturally replenished. And this particular statement talks about the recirculating aquaculture systems, which we discussed already. So, third statement is also incorrect. Hence, the correct answer is option D, 2 and 3 only. Now, this next question is a two-statement question. The first statement is, the term preventive detention is explicitly mentioned in the Constitution of India. This statement is correct. It is mentioned in Article 22 of Indian Constitution. Now, the second statement mentions, Parliament has the exclusive authority to make laws of preventive detention for reasons connected with defense, foreign affairs, and the security of India. So, whenever a statement mentions like exclusive authority to make laws, that means this statement is talking about the subjects mentioned under 7th schedule to the Constitution. So whether this preventive detention for reasons connected with defense, foreign affairs and the security of India is a subject under Union List? Yes, it is a subject under Entry 9 of Union List. That means Parliament has the exclusive authority to make law on this. So this statement is also correct. And here the question asks for the correct statements. So the correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. Now, this next question asks, what is H-1B program sometimes seen in news? Now, option A, it mentions a temporary non-immigrant visa category of USA. Option B, India's indigenous anti-missile program. Option C, a defense collaboration between Hong Kong and Britain. Option D, an initiative undertaken as part of the Vande Bharat mission. Now, the correct answer is option A only. It is a visa category of USA. Now, in this, related to option D, we recently discussed about one initiative, which is the Swadesh initiative. We discussed it on July 29th. Just keep that in mind. Now, let us take the next question. This is a two-statement question. And the question asks for not correct statements, that is incorrect statements. Now, the first statement is, boreal summer intra-seasonal oscillation creates significant wave activity over the northern Indian Ocean during summer monsoon season. This statement is correct. We discussed during the analysis. Now, the second statement is, BSISO dominates during June to October and Madden-Julian oscillation dominates during December to April. And this statement is also correct. We saw this fact also during the discussion. Now here, both the statements are correct, but the question asks for the incorrect statements. Since there is no incorrect statement, the correct answer is neither one nor two. With this, we have come to the end of today's discussion. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. Do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.